The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Sorry about this door of ours. We've tried oiling it 100 times, but it doesn't do the least bit of good. You see, this is the door to the Radio Mystery Theater, and its hinges have a mind of its own. And speaking of the mind, that's the subject of the story you're about to hear. We're going to take you deep into the recesses of a human mind. But you won't be alone on your journey. You'll be accompanied by 3 people. One of them is a psychiatrist, a man whose purpose it is to heal and cure. But the other two, well, I'm sorry to say that their intentions are not nearly so benevolent.
You can't do this to that man, Jimmy. He's sick. He's very sick. If we do something like this, we're liable to make him worse.
Do you think I care about him? All I care about is us.
But you might drive him out of his head. You might make him insane.
Our mystery drama, The Case of M.J.H., was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Henry Slessor and stars Augusta Dabney. It is sponsored in part by Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The mood of a psychiatrist's office is very special. A quiet mood, which gives no hint of the raging storms contained in the minds of those who lie on Dr. Vernon Cooper's leather couch and murmur their way through the secret fears and hidden angers of their lives.
I must have been, I don't know, 20 or 21, something like that. That was when I started putting on the pounds. My God, I put on weight so fast, I had to get rid of a suit I'd bought only 2 months before. It was, like you said, I got myself into a spiral. I couldn't get out of it. I didn't have any friends. I didn't think any girl would look at me twice, fat as I was. And the more I felt deprived, the hungrier I got. And the more I ate, and the more I ate, and... Oh, listen, I must have told you this story 12 times, Dr. Cooper.
No, it doesn't matter.
It's like a waste of money, isn't it? Me coming here twice a week and telling you the same things over and over.
Oh, there are differences. There are always differences in the way things are related. Those differences can be very significant.
Well, maybe.
Why are you looking at your watch?
Oh, I kind of my time's up, isn't it?
Yes, but why not let me tell you when the hour's up?
I guess I'm just anxious to get out of here. I've got something to do this evening.
Business appointment?
Well, like you said, Doctor, the hour's up. I don't have to say any more, do I?
All right, Mr. Harrison. We'll go on next time, then.
Right. Listen, would it be all right if I didn't come in at 3 o'clock on Wednesday? I'm busy then. Could we change the time?
Well, why don't you check with Miss Sheridan?
Yeah, I'll do that. So long, Dr. Cooper.
Bye.
Miss Sheridan.
Yes, Mr. Harrison?
Dr. Cooper said I could ask you if there was some other time I could come on Wednesday.
Well, let's see. You were scheduled for 3. Oh! Wait a minute. I see that Dr. Cooper has a free hour at 10, if you can make it that early.
Yes, that'll be okay. 10 o'clock. Thanks.
Bye, Mr. Harrison.
So long.
Dr. Cooper's office.
Hi, Maddie. It's Judy.
Oh, hello, Judy. How are you?
Okay. Listen, what are you doing tonight?
Oh, usual, I suppose. Eating dinner and watching television. Who knows? I might vary the routine by washing my hair.
You wouldn't like to go to that party with me?
What party? Oh, Judy, you don't mean that dancing school thing?
Yeah, that one.
Judy, why do you talk about those things as if they're really parties? Nobody gets invited. You pay to be there.
Oh, it's better than nothing, isn't it?
Not for me, it isn't.
But what choice do we have? There's got to be some way to meet a man in this town.
Well, all we ever met there are dancing instructors. And all they want is to sign us up for a 5,000-lesson dance course, payable for the rest of our lives.
Yeah, I guess you're right. What did you say was on TV tonight?
Maddie?
Oh, excuse me, do you have to go?
Oh, okay, I'll call you later.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Dr. Cooper?
You might as well run along home. I have some notes to transcribe, and I'm not expecting any more patients.
Well, I'm not in any hurry, Doctor.
No, you run along and enjoy your evening. Did I say something wrong?
I beg your pardon?
That was quite a face you made when I said that.
Oh, I'm sorry. My evening was just under discussion. Doesn't look that enjoyable.
Oh, well, whatever happened to that young man you were seeing a while back? Freddie something?
You're just a little bit behind schedule, Dr. Cooper. Freddie was gone with the wind just about a year ago.
Huh? Is it that long?
There never was much there to begin with.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Well, see you in the morning, as usual.
As usual. That's the phrase, all right.
So, Mr. Varadar, it says to Mr. Clark, who's supposed to be handling the money around here, you or me? So Mr. Clark says, why have we got adding machines in the office if you're not going to use them? So Mr. Aranowitz says, hey, Maddie, are you still there?
Yes, Judy, I'm here.
You haven't said a word for 5 minutes.
I wonder why.
Listen, am I keeping you from something?
Only from my dinner. I thought I had some macaroni and cheese left over from last night, but it had green mold all over it.
Well, what are you going to do then?
Well, at the cafeteria, I suppose.
I thought you hated that place. You said it was full of nothing but tired old men.
Yeah, old men, but fresh macaroni and cheese. I'll talk to you tomorrow, Judy, okay?
Yeah, all right. Hey, you know something?
What?
Right about now, I'd even settle for a tired old man.
Excuse me, miss.
Yes?
Maybe I better give you a hand with that tray. It looks like you're about to drop the whole thing.
Well, this darn book of mine has made the whole thing unbalanced.
Well, here, maybe if I grab the book.
Oh, thanks. That helps.
Hey, this is some book, all right. Must weigh 10 pounds.
It reads that way, too. Well, thanks again.
Why not sit down here at my table?
Well, okay. I guess it's just as good a table as any.
Of course, maybe you'd rather be by yourself to read your book.
No. I don't think I really feel like reading tonight.
Hey, what's the name of it, anyway? Hey, you know something? I can't even pronounce the name of it.
It's called The Psychopathology of Everyday Life. Sigmund Freud. I'm sure you've heard of him.
Yeah, he's a shrink or something like that.
Well, he was just about the first shrink, I guess.
No kidding. Hey, you must be a pretty brainy type reading stuff like this.
Well, I'm afraid I only read it because I think I should. Not much of it really penetrates.
Well, that's the way I feel about most books. Only I never cracked one with a title like that.
Well, you see, I work for a doctor.
Oh, hey, you a nurse?
No, not really. I'm just a receptionist, a secretary. But I did have some training, and I thought it would be necessary in order to work for that sort of person.
Well, what sort?
A psychiatrist.
Oh, you mean he's a shrink, too?
Well, I suppose you could call him that.
Well, what do you know? You know, all my life I wondered about those guys. I mean, what they do, how that psychoanalysis stuff works. It does work, doesn't it?
Oh, yes. There's no doubt of that. Oh, Dr. Cooper's done wonderful things for his patients.
You mean he makes crazy people well?
Oh, well, you can't oversimplify it that way. Well, his patients aren't, well, crazy, as you say. They're disturbed, and they have problems and neuroses, and, well, an awful lot of people do. Only, you know, not all of them seek professional help.
Yeah, well, that's for sure. Yeah, more nuts walking the street. psychopathology?
Yeah.
I don't know. This kind of stuff is too much for me. Hey, you're not eating your dinner.
No. Yeah, that's right. Well, then, you're not eating yours either.
Well, I'm not too hungry tonight. I'm just having coffee.
That's all?
Well, that's all I came in for. Tony, I guess I'm getting a little more than I bargained for. I mean, this nice conversation.
Do you live around here?
Well, not too far away. In fact, I was thinking of looking for a room in this neighborhood.
Just a room?
Well,
yeah, what else does a guy like me need? I mean, a guy without a family.
Oh, I see.
You know, I really can't get over it.
Over what?
The combination.
What do you mean?
I mean, a girl like you, a nice-looking girl like you, with brains, too. Listen, my name is Jimmy French.
How do you do?
Oh, hey, come on. Fair is fair. I told you my name. The least you can do.
Okay, my name's Maddie Sheridan.
Maddie?
Yeah, well, the truth is my name is Matilda, but I don't care for it very much, so my friends call me Maddie.
Well, fine. That's okay with me. My name is James. Well, I guess I should be running along. I gotta meet a guy downtown. Talk about a job.
Oh, you're not working right now?
No, well, I'm kind of between things, you know, but it'll be okay, I guess, if I just keep trying. That's the old American spirit, right?
Yes, of course.
It was sure nice talking to you, Maddie.
It was nice talking to you.
Maybe I'll see you around. Who knows, right?
Yeah, who knows? Dr. Cooper's office. Oh, yes, Mr. Harrison. No, the doctor hasn't come back from lunch yet. Oh, I'm sorry. Well, I'll tell the doctor that when he arrives. Now, will you be able to make your next appointment? Fine. I'll tell him, Mr. Harrison. Oh, Dr. Cooper.
Sorry, I'm back so late, Matilda. Mr. Harrison isn't here yet, is he?
No, he just called this minute. He said he wasn't feeling very well and, he won't be able to make it today.
Oh, yeah, I was afraid of that. Did he say what was bothering him?
No, that's all he said. But he promised that he'd be here for his next appointment. You look worried, Doctor.
Yeah, I am. Worried about that man. Sometimes I almost feel I should arrange another doctor for him. He just isn't making the progress I hope for. Oh, well. If he calls again, put him through directly to me. Tell him I could fit him in tomorrow if he wants to.
Yes, Doctor. Dr. Cooper's office.
Hi, is this Maddie?
Yes. Who's this?
Hi, Maddie. It's Jimmy French. Remember me?
Yes, I remember. Hey, how did you know where to reach me?
Well, I remembered what you said about this Dr. Cooper. I just looked you up. Listen, I hope you don't think I'm fresh or anything, but I was wondering if maybe you'd see me sometime, like tonight.
Well, I really don't know. It's sort of short notice.
Yeah, I guess it is. I don't blame you for saying no.
Oh, well, I didn't say no. I just meant that I was going to stay home and do some ironing, but I guess that can wait.
Hey, you mean it?
Yeah, of course I do. Do you think you can pick me up at my apartment?
Well, sure. Where is it?
It's 915 Southern Avenue on the first floor, apartment 2A.
Is 7:30 okay?
7:30's fine.
Oh, great. I'll see you then, Maddie.
One second. Who is it?
It's Mark.
Yeah, that figures. I knew you'd be coming around again.
That's right, Jimmy boy. I'm coming around every night until we get our business finished. Now, what do you say? Got a little installment for me?
Mike, listen, I got something better than an installment.
Come on, buddy. Don't tell me you got the whole thing. I'd keel over and die. You never had two bills in your pocket at the same time.
Mike, I got something going. I got something that's going to take a little time, but it'll be just what I need. What we both need.
You know what I need, Jimmy boy. I need my bread. All of it. And I need it now.
You'll get it. Every nickel, Mike. I'm going to start putting it all together tonight. 7:30 tonight.
Something tells me that Jimmy French isn't the best person that Maddie Sheridan could have met in the cafeteria that night. Of course, I might be wrong. He might be a very fine, upstanding young man whose only interest is getting somewhere in this world. Or is the phrase getting someone? We'll find out more when I return shortly with Act Two. Maddie Sheridan has had a remarkable evening. Remarkable simply because a man, young, attractive, and unmarried, has sought her out, treated her to dinner, taken her to a movie, and is now walking her back home. Not a very noteworthy event for many women, but for Maddie Sheridan, after a year of loneliness, a most significant evening indeed.
I don't think you really liked the movie, Jimmy.
Yeah, it was okay.
He seemed awfully fidgety.
Well, I get that way sometimes, fidgety. I don't know, maybe it wasn't the best way to... Well, you know, get to know somebody just by sitting in a movie house watching a picture.
I see. Oh, what happened about that job?
What job?
I meant to ask you at dinner. About that job interview you went on the night we met.
Oh, that. Well, that didn't work out, but... I'll get something. Don't worry about me.
What sort of work do you do, Jimmy?
Well, all kinds of things. Listen, what time do you have? I don't have a watch. I mean, I do, but it's broken. It's in the shop.
It's 10 minutes after 11.
Is that late? I mean, as far as you're concerned.
No, not very.
Well, maybe I could come in for a few minutes, huh?
Yeah, of course. If you want to. I could make some coffee, maybe.
Well, that'd be great.
Or maybe you'd like some hot chocolate. I still love hot chocolate late at night. I suppose I'll always be a child, even though I'm not a child.
Tell you the truth, what I'd really like is a beer, if you have one.
Yes, sure, I think I do.
Swell. You like living alone, Maddie?
Oh, I don't think anybody really likes being alone.
No, that's for sure. Hey, yeah, skip the glass. I'll drink it right out of the can.
Okay.
Thanks. Oh, that's good.
Jimmy?
Hmm?
Can I ask you something?
Well, sure.
Why are you having trouble finding work?
Oh, I don't know. It's just the times, I guess.
Well, when you say you do all kinds of things, what would some of them be?
Well, I guess anything that doesn't require brains.
Oh, come on, I don't believe that. You're very intelligent, seems to me.
Well, thanks, but you know better, Maddie. I mean, you know I'm not so good in the education department. I quit high school in my second term. Ooh, that was a big mistake.
Well, mistakes can be corrected.
Look, Maddie, you might as well know the worst about me. When I was a kid, I was in trouble all the time, stealing cars, stuff like that. I was even arrested a couple of times.
But you were young. You didn't know any better then.
Yeah, I guess.
It doesn't do any good to blame yourself for what you've done in the past. That just gives you guilt feelings.
Yeah, Doc, guilt feelings, right? Hey, how much do you charge for an hour?
I'm serious, Jimmy.
Yeah, I was afraid you might ask me something serious.
Would you rather I didn't?
No, the truth is I guess I want you to be serious with me. I haven't met anybody like you in a long, long time.
Then tell me about yourself, Jimmy.
Okay. Why, you want to hear the rough part? I'm a nothing.
Oh, I don't believe that.
Oh, you can believe it, Maddie. I'm a nothing. I don't have a trade. I can't do anything that'll make me a decent living. I got six jobs this year, none of them worth $100 a week. I'm not the kind of a guy who can, take a girl to fancy places, stuff like that.
I don't like fancy places myself.
Yeah, but you deserve something a lot better than cafeterias. I mean... You're really something special, Maddie. Didn't you know that?
Me?
Listen, I never thought a girl like you would look at me twice.
But why?
Oh, come on. You know, you're a million times smarter than me. Look, maybe I'd better be going.
Well, you haven't even finished your beer.
I'd better go. I'm just getting you all depressed, and then me, too.
Jimmy?
Huh?
Will you be calling me again?
Why do you want to hear from a guy like me? What for?
Hello?
Maddie?
Who is it?
Look, I'm sorry to be calling so late. I guess you must have been fast asleep.
Oh. Well, I did go to bed right after you left.
Yeah, I shouldn't have done it, but I just had to talk to you again, Maddie. I hated to see things left the way they were.
I don't know how things were left.
Maddie, would you see me again?
Of course I would.
You wouldn't be just saying that, Maddie.
Don't be silly.
Because now you know what kind of a bum I am.
I don't know anything of the kind.
Listen, this is crazy, but would you see me tomorrow night, too?
Yes, Jimmy. Sure, I'd be happy to see you tomorrow night.
Mr. Harrison not here yet?
No, doctor.
I should have guessed that he'd be late. He always is recently.
Dr. Cooper.
Yes, Maddie.
About tonight. I know we usually work a bit late on Fridays, but I was just wondering if I could leave at 5:30.
Well, yes, of course. Something special about tonight?
Yes, sort of.
I've been meaning to tell you how well you've been looking these days. You're doing your hair differently, aren't you?
Yes. Yeah. I got sort of tired of that old maid look.
Now, if I had to give a professional opinion, I might diagnose a condition of the heart.
All right. I'm here. I suppose you're all upset because I'm late.
Oh, no, Mr. Harrison, not at all. Please come in.
Hello?
Jimmy, it's all right. My place at 7, darling. Here we are. Roast beef, specialty of the house.
Yeah, looks good.
Would you pour the wine, darling?
Uh-huh.
You do like roast beef, don't you, Jimmy?
Yeah, sure.
Not too well done, is it? Oh, my oven heats up like Vesuvius sometimes.
No. It's just right.
Hey, Jimmy, what is it? Now, look, I can see that something is the matter.
Well, nothing's the matter. The roast beef is great. The table looks terrific. You look sensational. The only thing wrong with this whole thing is me.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about me, Maddie. About me and you and all the talk about, the future. I don't know what made me start that junk. Talking about marrying when I can't even get a job that lasts more than one week.
Jimmy, did you say marrying?
Well, sure. What else? You know, that's what I want for us, Maddie, more than anything.
But you've never mentioned that before.
How could I? What right did I have? I've been thinking about it so much, I'm sick. You know how that is. You can think about something and get sick. Headaches right now.
Oh, darling, poor boy, why didn't you say something?
No, it's not a case for an aspirin. It needs another kind of pill. A money pill, that's what it needs.
Oh, Jimmy.
Maddie, I told you a lie. I told you that I was a wild kid, a bad kid. That was a lie. I was just an ordinary kid. The guy I described, the crook, the punk who stole cars, the guy who got himself arrested twice. That's me now, Maddie. Right now.
You don't mean that.
I'm telling you the truth about myself. I'm not just a crook. I'm a cheap crook at that.
Oh, I just don't believe that.
Well, you better for your sake. It's even worse than you know. I'm not just broke. I'm in debt. I've been living on borrowed bread. If I don't pay it back, I'll either go to jail or get my head busted in.
Oh, Jimmy, no.
Well, that's what they do to guys like me.
Jimmy, listen. Listen, I have some money saved. I have a little over $300.
I owe $8,000, Maddie.
What?
I owe $8,000. How do you like them apples?
Oh, Jimmy.
Yeah, I'd be some husband for you, wouldn't I? Best thing for you is to lose me, honey. Lose me.
But I don't want to lose you. There has to be something that can be done, Jimmy.
Well, yeah, maybe. I've been thinking about it a lot.
What? What? What have you thought?
I thought that...
What?
I can't even tell you.
Oh, please. Come on. You have to.
Okay. It's the only time I'll ever ask you to do something like this, because I'm going to change right after it's over. I'll change, Maddie, so help me.
After what's over?
One more job. Only one, I mean it. But it's got to be something worthwhile. Now, Maddie, I want you to bring me the files from the doctor's office.
What?
I want you to bring me his files, as many as you can carry. Only the current cases, the people he's had recently.
But, Jimmy,
Let me finish. I want to borrow those files just overnight. I'll go through them real quick. So fast, you can have them back in the drawers by morning. Who knows? Maybe I'll find what I'm looking for right away.
Well, what are you looking for? What good will Dr. Cooper's files do you?
It's just an idea I got. I mean, this analyst stuff is pretty personal, isn't it? I mean, they have to tell the doctor everything, don't they?
Yes, of course. There can't be any secrets from an analyst. That would defeat the whole purpose.
Right, right. No secrets. So if I could see the doc's notes, if I could read through them, well, there's bound to be plenty of stuff they'd like to hide, stuff they'd pay money to keep quiet.
Jimmy, you're talking about blackmailing.
Your boss has a lot of rich patients, hasn't he? Now, you told me how much this analysis stuff costs. I mean, $60 an hour. They're going to be loaded,
Jimmy,
right?
Please don't ask me to do this.
Honey, they can afford a few grand. It wouldn't hurt them to part with a few grand. If I could just get enough to pay off the loan and maybe a little extra for us to get started.
No, I won't, Jimmy. I can't. I won't.
You won't even listen to me. You won't even give me a chance.
I couldn't do such a thing. I just couldn't.
Not even for me? For us?
No.
All right. That tells me what I want to know. Yeah, I guess you want me to beat it out of here right now, don't you?
No, I didn't say that either.
It just can't be both ways.
It isn't fair. It just isn't fair to ask me to do such a thing. It just isn't...
So long, man. I'm sorry about the dinner. You went to a lot of trouble, but I just don't have any appetite.
Jimmy! It's me, Jimmy.
Who?
It's Maddie.
Maddie, what are you doing here?
I just wanted to see you. I've been calling you for days.
I've been out.
Why didn't you call me?
You know why.
Jimmy, I missed you terribly.
I missed you too, Maddie. What's the use? What's the good of us seeing each other? It doesn't go nowhere, honey, don't you see?
Jimmy, can't you see what I have here?
What's that?
It's the files. It's not all of them. It's just his current patients.
Patients?
Yes, it's Dr. Cooper's files. I've brought them.
They say that love is blind. But in this case, you might also say that love is just a little bit larcenous, too. No, we won't pass judgment on Maddie Sheridan. We know the pressures that she faces. But who knows who else is going to be pressured as a result of this night's work? We'll find out very soon when I return with Act 3. Frantic activity in a one-room apartment rented by Jimmy French. A steady period which has lasted for many long hours. Folder after folder has been perused. Long, copious notes full of psychiatric jargon have been studied. And if Jimmy French is getting what he expected from the notes of Dr. Vernon Cooper, he certainly doesn't seem to be pleased with the results.
Nothing. I can't make heads or tails out of this
please,
stuff.
Please, Jimmy, try just to keep them in some kind of order. If you mix up the pages, I'll never get them back correctly in the files.
Why can't I figure out what he's talking about half the time?
I told you it wouldn't be easy, that they wouldn't make sense to you.
It's like reading a foreign language. Wait a minute. What are those type pages?
Well, they're transcripts of conversations. They're taken from a tape recorder. Well, Dr. Cooper doesn't always tape what his patients are telling him unless he thinks it's important.
Oh, boy, this looks like a long night. I haven't even eaten yet, have you?
No, I came right from the office.
I got some hamburger meat in the refrigerator.
You want me to fix it?
That'd be great.
All right.
Maddie?
Yes?
Look, I know how you feel about this, but you're not doing your boss any harm. These files will be back where they belong tomorrow morning.
You're all right, Jimmy. Well, it's all set. I couldn't find any hamburger rolls, so I hope white bread will do.
Maddie, I think I got it. I think I found the one.
You did?
He doesn't mention the guy's name, just his initials. M.J.H. Now, who is he? Do you know? Who's M.J.H.?
M.J. Oh, Jimmy. No, not that one.
Well, why not? Who is he?
Because his name is Harrison. It's Martin J. Harrison, and he's in Wall Street, and... Oh, I suppose he's very wealthy, but he's such an unhappy man. Jimmy, don't make it any worse.
He doesn't sound so unhappy to me. You read the stuff about him?
No, I don't know anything about him. Dr. Cooper types his own notes. They're confidential.
Well, I'll tell you one thing about the guy. He's got a girlfriend.
He does?
How old a guy would you say he is?
Oh, I don't know. I suppose he's close to 60.
Well, guess how old Diana is. That's her name, Diana. She's 18 years old. How about that? 18 years old. And, of course, he's married, isn't he?
Yes, he's married.
Diana. 18-year-old Diana. Boy, you should read the way he talks about her. You put the stuff in a book, you'd have a bestseller. Maddie, tell me more about this guy.
I don't know any more about him. All I know is that Dr. Cooper worries about him a lot. He says he's one of his most difficult patients.
Yeah. I can see that.
Sometimes he said that he shouldn't be treating Mr. Harrison, that he isn't helping him enough.
Well, maybe we can help him. Maybe we can help ourselves.
Oh, Jimmy. All this is so horrible.
His wife doesn't know about Diana, of course. He talks about that a lot. You know, the fact that his wife doesn't know, that it would kill her if she knew. He's worried sick about that. I mean, he's crazy about his wife, but he can't give up this 18-year-old stuff either. Can you imagine?
Please, Jimmy, stop it.
Oh, you can't feel sorry for a guy like this, can you?
Yes, of course I can feel sorry. Whatever's wrong with the man, he can't help himself. He just can't. That's why he's going to Dr. Cooper in the first place.
Yeah, and that's why I'm going to him. Now, where's that phone book?
Jimmy, I can't let you do this.
What?
You don't understand about Mr. Harrison. If you could just see the man, the way he looks when he comes into the office, he's so unhappy.
Look, you expect me to be sorry for this guy?
Yeah.
I bet he said it soft all of his life. I bet he's never had to kick around the street like a stray cat. All right, so now he's having himself a fling and he needs a shrink to make excuses for himself. Yeah, I'm sorry, baby. My heart doesn't bleed for Mr. M.J.H. It bleeds for me, Jimmy French.
Oh, Jimmy!
Hey, come on, cut that out, huh? Come on.
I can't help it.
Oh, come on, don't cry.
You can't do this to this man, Jimmy. He's sick. He's very sick. If we do something like this, we're liable to make it worse.
You think I care about that? All I care about is us.
But you might drive him out of his head. You might make him insane.
No, baby, no. I'm just going to make them a little bit poorer.
Oh, morning, Mr. Harrison.
Morning.
I'm glad you were able to keep the appointment.
Is the doctor in?
Yes, I'll tell him you're here. Dr. Cooper, Mr. Harrison's arrived. Yes, I will. You can go right in, Mr. Harrison.
Thanks.
Please come in, Mr. Harrison.
I suppose you've got a few nasty things to say to me today.
Well, why would you think that?
Because of the appointments I've missed. Or maybe it doesn't matter to you. You get paid no matter what, right? Probably a relief to you when your patients don't show up.
Please lie down, Mr. Harrison.
All right. Well, is it true? You're glad when we screwballs don't show up to bother you, aren't you?
Yeah, you happen to be wrong about that. I'm not glad to miss a session. I lose something by it. And more important, so do you.
$60, that's what I lose.
Can you give me any particular reason why you didn't show up last time?
You know the reason.
Do I?
You know very well. I needed a different kind of therapy, Doctor.
Go on.
You know what I'm going to say next.
I'd rather you did the talking.
I went to see her, of course. Diana.
I see.
Took me a whole day to figure out how to get to Diana's place and stay a while. Without my wife finding out, of course.
And did you succeed?
Yes, I succeeded. I told her I was coming to see you. That's always a good excuse, of course, going to see my analyst. So you see, you do come in handy sometimes, Dr. Cooper. You're worth $60 an hour, even when I'm not here lying on your couch. I'm on somebody else's couch.
You don't really consider me an excuse, do you, Mr. Harrison?
No, that's not what I meant, Doctor. You know what I meant.
Please continue.
Anyway, I made sure that Elizabeth didn't know where I was. I always have to make sure of it, that she doesn't suspect anything. I told you what it would do to her. She's a sick woman. That heart of hers is held together with tissue paper. Did I ever tell you how sick she is?
Yes, you've told me.
It would kill her if she found out about Diana. She'd just lay down and die. I can't have that happen, Doctor. She's everything to me. She's my whole world. Oh, I know what you're thinking. If she's my whole world, what am I doing with Diana? That's what you want to know, isn't it?
If you can answer the question, please do.
This is the thing. I can't answer it. I don't know. Every time I see that rotten little 18-year-old tramp. Tramp. That's all she is. Jail bait.
And yet you continue to see her.
I've got to. I can't help it. I've got to go on seeing her, Dr. Cooper. She's got a spell on me. A hex of some kind, I swear it. And yet, oh God, if Elizabeth ever knew, if she ever found out, it would kill her. My wife would die. And then I'd die too.
Jimmy, over here.
Oh, hi, honey. How are you?
I'm scared. I'm terribly scared.
Oh, now, forget that stuff. You got nothing to be scared about.
Why didn't you call me all day? Don't you realize what I was going through?
Well, I was too busy.
Jimmy, please tell me what's happening.
Okay, I'll tell you exactly. I called Mr. Harrison.
You really did?
I called him in his office. I told him I know all about his little 18-year-old and that if he didn't want his wife to find out...
Oh, dear Lord.
Now, listen. Tell me about Dr. Cooper. Everything's okay there, isn't it?
If you mean the files... No, he doesn't realize they were disturbed.
And what about his prize patient, M.J.H.?
Well, he didn't come in today. He broke his appointment today. He always does that when something's really bothering him.
Maddie, listen, this will all be over soon.
When? Please tell me when.
This weekend.
So soon?
Well, there's no use putting it off. I set the price high, so he's liable to bargain. I'm ready for that. I know how to compromise. Maddie, don't look like that.
I can't help it, Jenny. I feel so dirty.
I'm doing this for both of us, honey. You know that. Tell me you know it.
Yes, I suppose I know it.
And you love me too, don't you? Say it, Maddie.
I love you, Jimmy.
Morning, Maddie.
Morning, Dr. Cooper. How are you?
Well, not very well this morning, I'm afraid.
Why? What's wrong?
Well, I gather you haven't heard the bad news.
No, I haven't.
It appears that I've lost a patient.
Who is it?
My problem patient. Oh, I should have known better. I should have realized that he needed more help than I was able to give him. Then this might not have happened.
You don't mean Mr. Harrison?
Yes, Mr. Harrison. I knew there was a dark and dangerous force within him. That it was getting closer to the surface every day, but I never expected anything like this.
What happened?
He killed a man, Maddie.
He what?
I saw the violence in him, but I didn't foresee this.
Who did he kill?
A blackmailer. Man's name was French, James French. He was threatening to tell Harrison's wife about a young girl Harrison was in love with. Harrison wasn't going to pay him. Harrison went to see the man, and he brought a gun with him. He shot him dead. And now the police have arrested him.
Dear God.
A blackmailer. I can't understand it. I can't understand where he could have learned such a thing. How he could have made such a terrible mistake.
A mistake? What do you mean?
Well, I mean, there was no cause for blackmail, Maddie. No real cause, only the dark fantasies in his own soul.
Fantasies?
There was no girl named Diana. It was only Harrison's delusion, only a creation of his own guilt-ridden mind.
She wasn't real?
He was guilty about something that never existed. When a blackmailer threatened him, he protected his delusion with murder. The ultimate rationalization.
The ultimate rationalization. And suddenly, Mattie Sheridan's dream of the future is destroyed. But then, her dream was a rationalization too, wasn't it? She'd convinced herself that true love was more important than truth. Now, of course, she'll never know whether the love of Jimmy French was true or not. At least she's spared that cruelest of all fates. We'll be back shortly. You've enjoyed this little journey into neurosis, blackmail, and murder. They're the typical sort of menu on the Radio Mystery Theater, as our loyal audience has already discovered. We plan to bring you more of the same bill of fare in the future. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to see if I've managed to oil the creek out of our door. Our cast included Augusta Dabney, Jack Grimes, Alan Hewitt, Robert Maxwell, and Joan DeMarais. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown.
Now, a preview of our next tale.
There's nobody in there. I'm telling you, there's nobody in there.
What happened to my husband? What did they do to my husband?
Now, calm down, ma'am. Think. Are you sure this is the same?
I'm sure. I know. Don't you try to talk me out of it. I know. I was here exactly 1.5 hours ago. I was here. This place was open. This service station was operating, and there was a man here, Frank.
How do you know his name was Frank?
Because the name was written on his shirt.
Look, ma'am, I don't know what...
My husband. Now, what happened to him?
Ma'am, try to hold on to yourself. Don't pass out, please. Don't faint on me. I wouldn't know what to do.
Let me help you back to the cab.
Leo, what did they do to me?
Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and Anheuser-Busch Incorporated, Brewers of Budweiser. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.